had more than those people going there.
Yeah, somebody said roads to begin with.
Yeah.
So the idea is that, so up here you're grouping things according to closing the shape. So all of these things get grouped together. You don't even think of it as a grouping process because you don't see them as separate to begin with. That's pretty automatic. But you are actually taking these little bits and you're saying, this lot go together, these go together, but they don't, you know, two are separate. Two separate groups up here. And I think what they're trying to do here is to point out that you group these by rows according to similarity. So what they're trying to do is to make us aware of sort of things that are so obvious we don't realize we're doing them. Okay, so proximity, what do we see up at the top then? Because they're closer. That you're, sort of putting together.
Mm-hmm.
Now this one's a little bit more subtle. I don't know if this works the way that they intended it to work. But do you see the symmetry?
One interesting thing about proximity picture is that on the left square, rows appear to be more distinguishable than columns.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder whether it is by contrast with the right square.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's nice.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. I'm at a very funny angle here. So here proximity forces you to group the rows, but here they've changed it so that this proximity dominates and you group the blocks.
But if you close the right square,
yes,
the proximity in the left square arranges circles into holes.
I'm going to write something else up here. My sort of keyword happens to context. That is, what's around something might change the way you perceive it.
But by the fact that you've got the words there, it is leading us to think about certain things.
Yeah.
So that's part of context.
Yes, yes. So what about these keys? You see this as a pair of keys, a pair of identical keys. Would you agree with that?
No. They cannot be compatible as solid objects.
Because?
Unless we switch them. It is like left glove and right glove in this picture. A symmetric arrangement actually emphasizes that they are, what is the word for that? They mirror images of each other. The arrangement of them emphasizes this point, and we immediately see that actually by moving them in the plane, we can identify them. It is like left glove and right glove.
Okay, so if I've got two hands,
yes,
Are they the same?
No.
But I can still identify them.
By moving out from the plane.
That's okay.
Look, at the time they were developing all this, I wonder why they chose that particular image, because to a lot of people that would come across as a symbol for something, rather than as an example of synergy.
And it comes from a stained glass window. It's called St. Peter.
Mm. Well, to me it's a crossbeam pub.
The entrance of heaven.
Thank you.
Right, I can move on now.
You can't say they're symmetrical because one has is placed in front of the other, apparently. And then, so that means one has preponderance.
All right. Now, those chairs symmetrical. Take that around and around. This is what John said, jumping ahead. So we're actually not seeing, we're making sense of things. We're going to 3D, right? And that's what we did with the thing that looked like a mine, the sphere with all the spikes coming out, sort of 3D, and the cube is in sort of 3D. So we don't have to worry too much about two-dimensional geometry. Okay, and there's the Loch Ness Monster again, and they're making a slightly different point about it this time. Rather than just sort of grouping by similarity, what they're talking about is the pattern that continues, that you end up, well, you know, you just see it going on like that forever, or you might actually fill it in. You'll see some more examples of this. And a common bay, this is a swarm of birds, and this is that you're looking at them moving, big flock. Swarm it is. There's a lot of work now going on at the industry of being able to generate this for animation films. Fish swimming in the sea. They tend to call it swarming, or flocking, I suppose. Swarms of bees. Maybe it's insects, maybe it's birds. I'm not going to tell them. But you know, you can imagine that there might be one that's going off like that, and there might be more this way, and you'll tend to group all the ones who move them together in some kind of coordinated motion. And that's what they mean by common bent. They're going to end up doing the same thing, going the same way. So, we've got our list now of ideas from the Gestalt psychology and a few others that we've put in. Oh, not that. So we've got our shopping list here. Emergence, colour object. Is there any multi-stability there? Is there any invariance there? Grouping. Similarity.
Of course. I think every one of us groups is in the letters and the flower.
Yeah. So these big leaves go together.
Yeah.
There's actually also a bit of closure, I think, when you imagine them going all the way around. And
we move back on the corner.
I wonder whether it helps us to see the spiral pattern. Would it help us to know that this is a kind of plant which grows. We know that it is grown. And this pickup helps us to identify actually the direction of the growth. The spiral pattern got smaller and younger.
Yeah, but you think the growth was not green but gray and made from coffee? I mean, it's in the color. I think this is something that left there. We can do very many things with colors that are not.
We know what it is.
Some prior knowledge
we use.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And you'd say the common sense when you're talking about the growth and the movement, it's that growth forces shape, isn't it?
And I suppose we're visualising it as 3D as well, in a certain sense, even though it's just a 2D. It could be someone could have drawn it, I suppose, to be a photo, but there are ones converting it into a 3D.
It would be an awful lot easier to pop down into the green dress and put
it
across.
Alright,
so there's an awful lot going on here. There's common fate, similarity, continuity, these go on. These are going this way. These spirals are everywhere. But what this brings out is this fact that we're now so used to these fractions everywhere. And so we have to nowadays see similarities working across different scales. So how many scales are here? Well, there's the big sort of cone, the big conical shape. That's one. And then next scale down, we have these. That's two. But then with each of these, we get all these little ones. So there are three scales that are easy to see, and it might well be that if you really zoom in on each of these little bumps, it's got more texture in it. So maybe there are four scales there.
And it's come off something, and there might be more of them on the screen.
Yes, there's a big bunch of them. So.
And would you agree that it looks edible and even tasty?
It does really, doesn't it?
Yes.
I'm not sure. Well, it's a flower, I assume. The flowers, and they try to attract insects to pollinate.
And because it is very obviously young.
Right, yeah.
The younger moths are normally more edible than.
I've got a question. Which of these processes would explain? That I can put together a three-dimensional scene, because I know that the light in this scene would be to the left of the camera. And I also know where the camera is, and maybe I can also say how far this is away. I mean, is one of the processes, the ideas there contained in this?
We're just going to restrict ourselves to the Gestalt ideas.
Mm-hmm.
They talk about what consciousness is like, not how it gets computed, particularly. Just the fact that you will see it through dimensional group. Now, it's actually a very difficult problem to put all these things together. And if you go into the whole area robotics, computer vision, each of these becomes separate problems using depth, perspective, all of these things. So that's a huge area that I can't particularly talk about. And there are a lot of. So here you can use the light and shape cubes a lot.